Imagine a world in which a simple smile and twitch can make you to compose an email or send a personalized message. That world is just here in our group, Conformable Decoders. It was a beautiful, warm April night when I met Dr. Hawking at Harvard Society, where I was a junior fellow in the Society of Fellows before joining the Media Lab as a faculty. Indeed, it was taking too long for Dr. Hawking just to make a sentence via his computer interface. And at that night, I made my mind to tackle his struggle and design and develop a mechanically as well as visually invisible interface which can profoundly decode any facial micromotions and make individuals to talk seamlessly. It was actually our dream as well to try this invention on Dr. Hawking, who was a well-known ALS patient. But unfortunately, we couldn't have chance. He passed away. But we had privilege to work with amazing ALS friends, patients.
Well, that's a very interesting question. First time I met you was complete chance. At our fundraiser we're having in Cambridge for ALS TDI. Guys just happened walking through and you saw ALS and came by and sought me out. And kind of asked if I'd be interested in that.
And we work not only with Dennis, also his family, his daughters and wife, beautiful wife and dedicated wife.
So obviously met my wife Suzanne. We've been married for 18 years, is that right?
We've been married for 18 years, yes.
Oh, we have four girls.
Not only Dennis and his family, we also met Gerber family. John and Phil.
Well, I met her 50 years ago. 50 years ago last November. Yeah, so it's almost 50. Yeah, it's 51 years now.
And we'd been married 46 years. We knew for a long time something was wrong.
When I first found out, I was kind of like disbelief. Not really sure what to think. From diagnosis, you get like, it's like a 2 to 5 year life expectancy. So, tough to take. But, like I said, friend, family. So.
And yes, I have my bad days, but, I think because of the support I have of family and friends, I'm able to proceed onward.
It really does feel like revolutionary research. I feel like I am doing things that no one else on this campus is doing.
And that's what Conformable Decoders is trying to do, is create devices which people can use in the daily life.
As a group, Conformable Decoders are focusing on designing and fabricating mechanically adaptive electromechanical systems for biomedical applications.
And these devices are meant for use in early detection of disease or treatment of disease, or to make, for example, communication easier. Or daily life easier for patients who are suffering from terminal illnesses.
Our ultimate goal is actually try to understand what our biological language is trying to tell us so that we can create a smart interface between human beings and patients and medical doctors to do a better personalized treatment. It's a very well-known fact that today's electronics are stiffer up to 6 orders of magnitude compared to soft tissue. And when you want to integrate this electronics with soft biology, there are severe challenges in mechanics mismatch and geometrical form mismatch. So in our group, we use special, elegant, and simple microfabrication techniques and tricks which allow us to make any electronic devices in soft and elastic way that can match those of human tissues.
Yeah, so if we're speaking about communication devices for ALS patients, currently the main drawbacks are the fact that they're bulky and they're not portable, or they're hard for the user to wear and use on a daily basis.
They can be very finicky in the sense that you need ideal conditions to be able to work with them.
Texting has become a lot more of an issue where it's hard for me to hold the phone, my fingers aren't really working that well, so it's kind of tough to work my phone. It's a lot more difficult. When you're a crowd, you're kind of competing in conversation, so to speak.
And so we could be sitting around a circle of friends and she can try to speak and I can get close and hear her, but it's not clear. So you get left out of a conversation.
Right.
I think that's the hardest part of ALS, is being able to lose the ability to communicate. Humans are very social creatures and we need to be able to communicate with those around us. With ALS, you eventually lose that ability without the help of technology.
Given the drawbacks of the current devices, we decided to create a conformable device which would overcome, for example, the bulkiness and the lack of intimate contact with the skin.
You don't need perfect lighting and you don't need to keep your body in this one position all day long. You can move around more. We wanted a portable device and we wanted to keep it as low cost as possible.
It's completely skin-like, so once you put it on, you'll forget that it's even there.
Being able to move the muscles of the face is something that we've been doing our whole lives. And just tracking those muscles to different movements on a screen or different letters or phrases is a really natural way to communicate.
So the functional material that we use is the piezoelectric materials. Specifically, we use aluminum nitride because it provides a high enough sensitivity while being able to couple and conform without breaking upon experiencing strains which occur on the face. But the PDMS layer, it's silicone, so it's very soft, and it has elastic modulus, which is comparable to the human skin. So that is what allows the piezoelectric aluminum nitride to then couple very nicely to the human skin. So the day of the trials, we met Dennis and Phyl in their car. We brought them into the office. First, we had lunch with them and we talked with them, discussed their lives, what they like doing. And after we had lunch, for Dennis, we did trials with the real-time decoding. So we put the device on his face. I set up my end, which is the Raspberry Pis and the computer. And then we just run my program. And then we measure the accuracy. As he's doing the trials, we can measure how accurately our device and system can detect the motions on his face.
It was truly an intimate bonding between our group and our ALS friends.
Yeah, I would say we really appreciate the opportunity to be part of this groundbreaking, communication piece.
Well, after I figured that it wasn't really going to benefit me, I decided it's time I did something for the future. And it seemed like a golden opportunity to do that.
I just want to do whatever I can to help the entire ALS community. There's no sense in me having this sitting on the sidelines just having no input into what's going on, doing nothing to help the overall picture of it. So I thought if there's something I can do that can help everybody else in some way, then it's worthwhile. And I thought, what better place than MIT to come up with something like that. And after I met you guys and spoke with you guys that day in August, I just got a good, you meet somebody, you get a good feeling about them. I said a good feeling about you guys.
Getting the chance to work one-on-one with the people that you're impacting, I think is the most important thing you can do as a researcher.
It's very easy once you start a research project to sort of just end it. and be like, okay, that's all I'm doing. But when you test it on people, you can see the flaws, or you can see where you can improve more, or, and on the flip side, you can see all the things, all the great things that it does to help the people that it's intended to help. And that's very motivating for you to continue that research work and actually bring it from the research stage to the market, to where people can actually use it in their daily lives.
Do you have a personal message to your grandchildren, mm-hmm. or maybe 10, 20 years later?
Oh my goodness.
I'll just tell them to watch their grandmother, because she is amazing.
You're amazing too.
You can make me cry.
Geez, my message for the future is, guys, don't give up. That's it. I don't really have anything profound, but just keep up the fight.
Follow their heart. Follow their dreams.
I would like to express my special thanks to our friends who became a part of our research team and project, and not only to them, as well as to their dedicated families. And the scientific world and community would be thankful to them forever, and they would be eternal on our upcoming paper. But we know very well that this is just a start, and we are very much looking forward what the future will bring to us and how these devices will be used by many people all around the world.